Central Florida. So how was your Memorial Day weekend, Mr. Roberts?
It was restful. I kind of just did some stuff around the house a couple days and visited some friends and just kind of took off the rest of the time, just did some reading and just relaxed. It was nice. How about yours?
As we were discussing earlier before we went on, it's my daughter's 17th birthday. And as such, we took Friday, which was her actual birthday, to celebrate with her. You know, we got to still practice social distancing. So it's not really preferred. You know, they would rather have their friends with them. But right now, while they're still asking people to practice social distancing. So we made sure to lavish plenty of attention on her. And then Friday, our oldest, who didn't have to work, Saturday. So Saturday, we take the entire family back to the same beach. Enjoy the beautiful weather that we had. Yeah. We were so glad we did that because it, you know, come Sunday and then Monday, the storm started rolling in, and
that's right.
We felt like we kind of missed the bullet, so to speak.
Yeah.
So I felt kind of happy about that.
Yeah.
But other than that, you know, I had no intention of working the weekend and ended up showing houses on Monday after all.
Yeah. Well, you do what you have to do.
My buyer's a first responder, so when she's available, I'll do what I can to accommodate her schedule, considering all that they do for us.
Yeah.
So I had no problem with that, so to speak.
Yeah.
At any rate, happy
belated birthday to your daughter.
She is definitely been spoiled. We'll just make sure she's been spoiled and. Of course, you know she's loved, so she doesn't have to worry about that whatsoever.
Oops.
And sorry about that. We had a little feedback. But anyway, I figure what we'll do is, like we normally do, I'm going to start with sharing the numbers, sales, new listings, pending sales, and recent closures, starting in our hometown of Castleberry, and then going to Seminole County. So these are the numbers for the city of Castleberry in the last 7 days. So in the last 7 days, there were 8 new listings, 8 new homes on the market. There were 21 listings, existing listings that went under contract, 21 pendings, and 5 closings, five brand new home buyers in the last 7 days. Now, I was looking at last week's numbers, per se, and last week we had 7 new listings and 30 new contracts and 9 closings. Now, some people may look at that and say, well, it looks like the numbers are down. However, within the last 7 days, we had basically a federal holiday. We had a 3 or 4 day weekend.
Yeah.
So between lenders and title, they were not open on Monday. So the numbers are still holding, I think they're still holding pretty strong, you know, for the past 7 days, just in the city of Castleberry alone, the numbers are holding strong. And then with respect to Seminole County, in the last 7 days, 115 new listings, 194 homes that listings have gone under contract, they're pending, and 107 closings. Then again, I looked, I was like, well, you know, what was last week's number? What was the numbers comparison before? Well, last week we had 136 new listings, 244 new contracts, 126 closings. So though the numbers may be down from new listings and new contracts, again, we had a federal holiday since we last met. That was Wednesday. We had Memorial Day, and some people took the 4 full days if they could. So you know, there's definitely, it's showing that the strength of there, the market and the activity is strong. And there's, now's the perfect time to buy and the perfect time to sell. And then one thing that we were kind of discussing here just briefly a moment ago, with respect to, give me 1 second. I'm going to have to shrink my screen here. was the, I just did it again. Monday morning quarterback. It's a report made available to realtors every Monday morning. So each week we can go through and kind of look at the weekly market report. This is what your agent should be doing for you to give you an idea if you're selling a home. They know that the different stats and things that are important to the market at hand. And then by the same token, this is the report I wanted to show everybody. And what it shows you is over the past week up to the 23rd, the number of sales, and then that breaks down the number of sales. How many were bank-owned properties, how many were short sales, and how many were traditional sales. And it breaks it down by price point also. Now, I a lot of people don't see this information quite, but this is something I think that needs to be shared so that you can see there is a difference in a strategy when it comes to pricing your home right and figuring out exactly how long does it normally take for a home to sell. If you look under this column here where it says under 250,000, 2 months of inventory, they've actually rounded up. It's a little less than 2 months, but they're saying 2 months of inventory. 6 months is healthy. 2 months of inventory. We're just that short of inventory. They show you things such as the list price, the original list price, average final list price, the sale price. What's the difference between the different prices, original to final list price? Kind of gives you what's the percentage that you're going to get. If you list it for $100,000, you're probably going to get $95,000 or $97,000 for the listing. That's on average.
Okay.
Kind of gives us idea. How many days does the listing stay on the market? As far as the average listing to contract, combined average days to contract, listing to closing, things of that nature. So you know approximately how long it's going to take the entire process to go through. And then if you look, this is kind of interesting here. The average, if we'll say the beds and baths, a single family home priced under $250,000 usually has a 3-bedroom, 2-bath, no half bath, and it has 1,413 square foot, heated square footage of the home. So this is information that when we come to you and we're looking to sell your home, we try to use this data to support what we call, you'll always hear this term, the comps, the comparative market analysis, the comparative homes. What we do is we look at your home, we look at the homes that were built within plus or minus 3 to 5 years of your home, generally within a half mile if we can. The same subdivision or neighborhood is ideal because most of those homes are built at the same time. So what has sold, what is active, what is sold, and what is pending? Preferably in the last 90 days for the sold and pending. And we get an idea what the market says your house is worth. The realtor does not determine the price of your home. The market determines the price of your home. The value of your home has never been determined by an agent. It's always will be determined by the market.
Yeah.
And we use this information along with what we do our market analysis to determine what you should and give you a range recommendation, because we're only consultants. This is what we would recommend you price the home at. I just thought this would be, this is kind of a neat little piece of information that a lot of people just don't know exists. And of course, it's something that realtors have access to. However, Deborah and myself, we share this when we go on a listing appointment. Now, this is only taken into consideration Lake, Orange, Osceola, and Seminole counties. Now, as we were discussing, I went and looked over the past 7 days. I looked at Orange, Lake, Seminole, Osceola, and I included Volusia because I do a lot of business in South and West Volusia to see what were the numbers of all those counties over the past 7 days. I've shown you Castleberry, and I've shown you Seminole County by itself. But when you take all of those five counties, there were 884 new listings in the past 7 days. There were 1,348 pendings in the last 7 days. And there were 668 closed transactions in the last 7 days. This is the perfect time to sell, and this is the perfect time to buy. The rates are still very low. And with that little segue, I want to hand it off to my friend here, Mr. Roberts. Dan, take it away.
All right. Thanks, Chuck. The biggest thing that I noticed there over the last 2, 3, 4 weeks is that you're getting a lot more pendings than you are new listings. So that's just going to make it even harder because your inventory is dropping every week, basically, right?
Right. It's contributing to the, we already are at a shortage of inventory.
Yeah.
And especially if it's move-in ready, people are jumping on multiple offers on the homes because they want something they can move into and they don't have to do any work to.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So yeah. So that's the biggest thing that I have noticed over the last couple of weeks. So if people are looking to list their house, now's the time because they're going to probably sell it pretty quickly and for a decent price right now. So,
oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So
even if your home needs just minor repairs, generally what most people don't want to have to do, they don't want to have to replace the roof,
right,
or the air conditioning, yeah, or major plumbing or major electrical. You know, if there's a couple things that need to be fixed, most buyers may be willing to overlook some of those, but it's the main four, the primary four, as we say.
Yeah.
Plumbing, heating, air conditioning, electrical, and the roof. If those are in good shape, the bones are in place, buyers are pretty forgiving.
Right, right. And it's going to be kind of like that for a while with the way the inventory is. So, yeah. So, from a lender's perspective, you know, interest rates are still incredible. I mean, they are still at historic lows to where they have been. They're holding pretty steady over the last 2 months. And considering where we are, we don't know how the economy is going to come out of this whole coronavirus situation. We expect them to stay low for a while. We never know how long because it's guessing what the interest rates are going to do. But right now they're really low. And I know we talked about last week, we showed some charts about renting versus buying right now, because rents are very high. The average rent, say in Sonoma County, is $1,700 to $1,900, where you can take that house that you can buy for, say, $225,000, and your payment will be in the $1,200 or $1,300 range. So you're actually saving money by buying a house now with the interest rates so low, as opposed to renting, because rents are so high. And then a couple other things I just want to talk about today. I know a lot of people would like to buy with some down payment assistance from the county or from private funds. Just want to let everybody know Orange County has been open. They have three different levels. The two lower levels of income are still open. The moderate one will open July 1st. And then Sonoma County just came out the end of last week and said that they are open until June 30th. And the money is first come, first served basis. So they're open for now until the end of June. So there's about a month or so there that they're going to be open with funds, which is good to hear. Because in most cases, the counties don't get their funds until July or August. And they go pretty quickly because they don't get really a lot because it's all funded through the state. So Sonoma County is open again, which is great to hear. So anybody that was thinking about buying in Sonoma County and needs down payment assistance, is a great time to look and see if you qualify for that. So like I said, that'll be through June 30th. They're taking applications.
Now, where would they go to find out about this information? Is this something they come to you? Is this something they need to go to a particular website, or how would they go about, one, finding out what they need to do to apply for this money and to see if they would even qualify?
Yep. They can just come to us as a lender. We are certified with the county to be able to do loans with them. So yeah, we have all the information. We can have a, you know, short conversation to figure out what their situation is, kind of get an idea of what their income levels are, because it's all based on income and household size as to who qualifies and who doesn't. So we have all that information for all the counties, but considering that Seminole and Orange are open right now, we definitely can help them with the questions that involve with Orange and Seminole County.
So now how does, what is the general, if you don't mind, just if someone says what is it, what's the down payment assistance exactly?
Sure, exactly. So down payment assistance is, if it comes from the county, in most cases is a grant that they give you money to help cover your down payment. Like if it, you are doing an FHA loan, you would have to put 3.5% down minimum. And so they will help you pay some of the down payment there and some of your closing costs. So basically, like I said, it's all based on your income level and the number of people in your household. So say if you're just a single person, as opposed to a family who maybe has two kids where there's four, the income level for a family of four will be higher than it will be for the single person. So if just, this is just pulling this out of the air, I don't have the chart in front of me, say that for a single person, the maximum income could be $45,000. For a family of four, it may be $65,000. So since they're a bigger family, they qualify for it more than say a smaller family does. They give you money to cover closing costs and down payments, because a lot of people would love to buy a house, but they don't have the funds saved up to do it. And in this case, they can get the money from the county. They don't have to make any payments on it like you do on the mortgage. And depending on the county, they're all a little bit different. After a certain number of years or a certain time frame, 5 years or 10 years, depending on the county, it's forgiven as long as you still own the house and you still are occupying it. You can't turn it into a rental property, because then all of a sudden the money is going to be due and payable. Say if it's one of the counties and it's a 10-year forgiven plan, you have to stay there and live in it for 10 years and then it's fully forgiven, depending on the county. If you sell it at year 9, you probably have to pay it back. But if you stay there a certain amount of time, it's a great way to get some money to help you with down payment and closing cost assistance.
You know, it's ironic you bring that up with respect to the need to stay in the home. If you do get down payment assistance, make sure you go over the agreement, or make sure you keep, not only keeping a copy of the agreement as you should, all paperwork, make sure you go over it and you understand it. We recently had someone that was wanting to sell, got to the point where we have an offer, we're under contract, and they didn't realize that because they were 6 months shy of their 10-year time frame, they were going to have to pay all that money back. If they simply waited 6 months, it's all forgiven.
Right.
So if by chance you've used the down payment assistance and you're looking to sell, make sure you know where you stand with respect to the forgiveness period. And if they have used down payment assistance in the past, are they eligible to use it again?
That's a good question.
Is that county by county maybe, or is that something?
It's probably county by county. As to, obviously, you would have to have sold the first house, because you couldn't have two going at one time.
Right.
And it's in most cases, it's first time home buyers. But what that means is you have not owned a home for the last 3 years. So they couldn't go in and say, oh, we want to upsize to a bigger home, we're going to sell ours and buy a new one at the same time. You couldn't do that, because in most cases, you have to be full first time home buyer. So you have to sell it, rent for 3 years, and then you're considered a first-time home buyer again.
And for those people that maybe fell victim to the housing crash in the 2000s, we'll say 2008, if you may be, well, you know, I had a house and then I lost it due to the housing crash and the financial crash. Would I be eligible as a first-time home buyer? The government wants you back in the home, and they want these programs are to help you get back on your feet. Right. Because if you were a homeowner, you know the benefits of home ownership, and you're the very person that they want to get in a home.
Exactly. So yeah, and when you say the benefits, I mean, we talked about rental rates a few minutes ago, and rental rates go up every year. And so 10 years from now, if you're still renting that same house that you're paying $1,800 a month for, it was going to be $2,500. And then you look at your mortgage payment, the taxes and insurance may go up very small amounts each year, but your principal interest stays the same on a fixed rate mortgage. So your mortgage payment may go up a very tiny little bit, but your rent is going to go up a lot more if you're renting.
Yeah, your rent's going to outpace any increases your mortgage may see.
Exactly. So, yeah. So, and then the other thing that I just wanted to cover today is, you know, back when all this started back in March and the markets kind of went crazy, a lot of the programs were put on pause or the guidelines got tougher. A lot of the guidelines have come back. And then we saw this week that our if anybody's looking to buy or build a home, our construction to permanent loan product is back up and running. It was paused until this week and it's back up. So if anybody's thinking about building a home, you can actually use this program to actually buy the land as well. So that's back up and running for anybody that's looking to build a home as opposed to buying an existing one or buying one directly from a builder. So that's available once again, which is great. And I know I had touched last week that the bank statement loans for the self-employed are back again, which is great as well. So the programs are starting to slowly come back. And the guidelines for the regular programs are slowly coming back to where they were. So things are starting to get back normal, which is nice because it was a couple months of craziness there for a while.
Oh yeah. So back to the new normal.
Yes, exactly. So,
well, I would say we got about 5-6 minutes left on our proposed time. I haven't seen anything come through. However, I think that, if anyone has any questions from you, Dan, how would they reach out to you?
Yep. They can either call me. My phone number is 407-927-5309. And that's my cell phone, so you can get directly in contact with me. And my email is daniel.roberts@primeres.com.
And then if you're looking for a husband wife realty team to represent you, you know, to let our home team find your team's home. We're Deborah and Chuck Morris from Keller Williams Advantage Realty. Phone number is 407-687-8300. That's 407-687-8300. Or you can email us at info@deborahmorrishometeam.com. That's info@deborahmorrishometeam.com. Well, thank you again, Dan, and I look forward to talking to you again next week.
Yep. Thanks, Chuck. We'll see you then.
All right.